Yeah. You ready? Hey. Let's go. Bet.
Hey, I gotta ask one more time, how you guys doing tonight? I love it. Hey, tell you what, after service, we're gonna start some fires, and this is the Halloweeny party, so we're gonna roast some hot dogs. We're gonna roast some hot dogs over the fire. It's gonna be awesome, but we are a little bit behind schedule, so everyone focus in. Focus in. I love it. Hey, I asked this a couple weeks ago, and without all the Christmasers and the Easters and everything booing, because I agree Christmas is the best holiday factually. But does anyone have their favorite holiday as Halloween? It's a good thing you didn't raise your hand if you did, because you'd be alone. Wow. All right. Hey. Usually, Halloween, it's a holiday where people dress up as monsters, ghosts, serial killers. My wife has a very unhealthy obsession and curiosity about serial killers. She watches like every documentary out there she's seen about. Probably. But listen, hey. Dial it in. Focus in. Listen. Shh. I love it. Shh. Boys over here. I love it. I'll be honest with you guys. We have a lot of fun. We have a lot of fun at the Halloween party, don't we? We have a great time. We do. No need to cheer. But here's the reality. The Halloween party every year seems like God moves in a special way. God always moves and speaks in a special way. There's always life change. People have great moments with God, and it's not because it's necessarily Halloween. I think God enjoys flipping the switch and saying, no, a dark holiday like Halloween, I'm going to make something good happen on a Wednesday night in a room like this. Amen. Amen. In the name of Jesus, that's right. But listen, hey, listen. But the biggest reason why a lot of cool things happen at the Halloween party every year isn't because it's some kind of party or we decorate or we wear costumes. It's because so many of you come with an expectancy that God's going to do something because he did something last year or he did something the year before that. And here's the reality. God sees faith and rewards it. And last night, I was sitting there finishing my message. I'm in a pretty busy season, so I didn't finish it till the night before. It's tragic. And my wife and I, we bought a fixer-upper. I wasn't going to share this, but we bought a house that was built in the 1940s. And every time you think you're done finding surprises, you just find more surprises. It's really bad. I have found leaks. All right, the number one enemy of construction is water. Keeping water out, because water will destroy everything. And I have found a leak in every area of that house. Just water everywhere. And I get home, and it was raining yesterday, and I'm getting ready. I'm excited. I'm like, oh, it's going to be a good night tomorrow. I'm going to write my message. And I step up to my computer, and I feel water on my feet. And I go, oh, no. And I'm like, okay. So I start looking up, and I'm like, is there dripping water? I'm like, I don't see any dripping water. And so then I'm like, well, where's it coming from? And I see water just oozing up from the basement floor. Because water had leaked into the house from the rain and flooded underneath the basement flooring. And then I found some mold that was forming and all this stuff. And I was like, man, I can't get away from these water problems. And I was discouraged. And I was like, now I don't really want to write a sermon. Now I'm just kind of mad. But God spoke to me last night, and I'm saying this because I want you to have the right expectancy for this message, and that is this. It didn't matter what was happening in that moment. What mattered and what God spoke to me is that I have a word for those students tomorrow. You need to sit down and write that sermon because I'm going to speak to them. and that was for you guys. Amen. Listen, you're not here on accident. You're here because God wanted to speak to you tonight. Yeah. Do you believe that?
Yeah.
Good. Very good. Well, we're going to get a little serious for a little bit then. We've been talking about spiritual warfare. And a couple weeks ago, we talked about putting on the armor of God. The best offense is a good defense. There is a war for every single one of your souls. You understand that? There's a war that you cannot see being fought for you, for your eternity. Because the reality is, and we don't like to talk about it, but it's in the Bible and it's true, and we don't sugarcoat things here. You will spend an eternity in one of two places: heaven with God or hell. That's just the truth. And there's a war being waged for you right now that will determine one of those two places. And we've been talking about this, so if this is your first week here, your second week here, you're coming in at a good time because this is very, very important for all of us. We need to put on the armor of God. We need to prepare ourselves to defend against the lies of the enemy. We need to get water. Not just water as in the physical water that we drink, but the word of God. We need Jesus in our life, the water that keeps us going and sustains us in this war. That's part of how we fight back. You can't fight back if you're dead tired. Pastor Payton, myself, and a few guys learned that real quick when we camped out on dirt last weekend. We literally slept on the dirt with no food and chopped wood all day for 3 days. How was it? I've never been more tired and hungry in my entire life. In the woods, in a mysterious place. All I can say is we were surrounded by trees and we could have gotten lost if we really wanted to. We did have toilet paper. We did not have a shovel. Anyways, there will be a video coming out explaining that, guys, but we're gonna get to the good stuff here. Tonight I'm gonna finish this series off with how we really fight back. We know that we need the armor of God. We know that we need the word of God in us to replenish us. But now how do we really fight back? When we're at rock bottom, when we're chained and shackled and the world is coming in on us and we're surrounded, how do we fight back? When you're doing all the right things, guys in the front, when we're doing all the right things, you guys, anyone ever asked the question, why do bad things happen to good people? It's one of the big questions that people ask and why a lot of people decide not to believe, because they see good people out there that are doing good things and yet life is so unfair. But the reality is that it's not that God is mean or bad. God is always good. The truth is that we're in a fallen world. And unfortunately, no matter how good you are, sometimes you're on the unfair side of that. We're going to see that here in this story. The Apostle Paul, he was traveling and he was going to all these big cities to preach the message of Jesus. And he wanted to go to what is modern-day Turkey. It says in the book of Acts, he wanted to go to what we know as modern-day Turkey. And it says that the Holy Spirit forbid him from going there. Paul wanted to go do a good thing. He wanted to go tell people about Jesus in Turkey, but weirdly enough, the Holy Spirit said, you're not going there. So then, Paul decides, I'll go somewhere else then. I'll go to this other place called Bithynia. Look at your neighbor, say Bithynia. Bithynia. I don't know if I said that right or not, but we're going to roll. So he wants to go and preach the message of Jesus, the best thing you could ever do. But again, the Holy Spirit said, you're not going to go there. So if I'm Paul, I'm pretty confused. I'm like, dude, do you want me to tell people about you? Or like, should I just go get some food and hang out? Like, what do you want me to do? Well, God eventually leads him and a few others to a city called Philippi. Philippi was a Roman colony, basically in Greece. And they go there, and there is no church established. In fact, even as far as Jews go, there was a very small population of Jews there. So there was a bunch of other religions that were relevant here: Greek religion, Roman religion at the time. And we see them walk into this city. We pick up in Acts 16, verse 16. It should be up on the screen. It says, as we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners much gain by fortune-telling. She followed Paul and us, crying out, these men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation. And this she kept doing for many days. Paul, having become greatly annoyed, turned and said to the spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus to come out of her. And it came out that very hour, basically saying it came out immediately. We'll pause there for a sec. This essentially possessed slave girl was, it says it was, she was possessed by a spirit of divination. But the actual text there says that she was possessed by pythonia, as in a python. She was possessed by a snake. And in that area, the snake was symbolic of the god Apollo, the Greek god Apollo. If you were here in the past when Pastor Payton preached angels and demons, he would have talked a little bit about this. The fact is that a lot of false gods in the world are actually just demons looking for glory, looking to deceive, looking to lead people away from the real God. And this, there was actually, in this area, we see historically, outside of the Bible, if you do your research, there was a shrine to the python Apollo right in this area. So these people were engaging with these false gods, and this girl ends up possessed. And what I want you to realize from this is that if you engage in the wrong side of spirituality, you are putting yourself in grave danger. That is the reality. That is spiritual warfare. They were engaging with false gods, aka demons, and they reaped the price of it. But Paul got annoyed. And what's interesting is what the possessed girl was actually saying was true. They were servants of the Most High God. They were preaching a message of salvation. So why would Paul get annoyed with her for preaching the same message that they were coming to preach? Well, because there were so many gods in the area that people worshipped, people at that time would have heard, oh, they're servants of the Most High God. They must serve my God. So actually, when people heard this possessed girl saying this message, they actually would ignore Paul because they're just thinking, oh, we must think alike because I believe in the Most High God. So that must be who he's talking about. And at the same time, Paul doesn't need help from a demon to spread the word of God. He wasn't looking for a demon to help him spread the message of Jesus, because clearly the demon wasn't actually trying to do that. So he got annoyed, and he sent the demon out. Here's what happens next in verse 19. It says, but when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, these men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city. They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept our practice. The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates tore the garments off them and gave orders to beat them with rods. And when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. Having received this order, he put them in the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. There's a few things you won't see right in the text here that I want you to understand. Paul, Silas, and the other two that were with them were doing the right thing. They were spreading the message of Jesus. It is the greatest thing that they could do, that we can do, and they were being obedient to God. Not only that, but this was not the first place they wanted to go. This was not the second place they wanted to go. But God had steered them in different direction after different direction until they ended up in this city. If I was Paul and Silas, I'd be pretty frustrated, don't you think? I'm like, God, I didn't even want to come here. And now I'm doing what you told me to do, and I'm getting beaten and thrown in prison. Why? What's happening? It says they got thrown in the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. You see, the type of stocks that they used in the inner prison were these stocks that latched onto your legs and pulled your legs apart. So you are in the inner prison. This prison was separated from everyone else in the prison. They didn't put lights next to this inner cell. It was pitch black, it was cold, there was no one around you, and you were getting your legs essentially pulled apart by these stocks. Even more than their beatings, when people would get put in the inner cell, they would actually suffer the most from cramping because of the way their legs were positioned. They would just sit there and cramp nonstop. Anyone ever get a leg cramp? That is excruciating pain, horrible pain. But that doesn't change the fact that they were just beaten with rods by an entire crowd of people. All because they were doing the right thing. Do you see, students, that the devil, the enemy, is celebrating in this moment thinking, I stopped them. Surely they will get discouraged. Surely they will stay in the inner prison and suffer and rot, and they will not make it out. The people that usually went to the inner prison were killed. Listen up in the front. It wasn't a good situation for them. It says in Acts 16:25, at about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bonds were unfastened. You should know, students, that there were not really earthquakes in this area. And not only were there not typically earthquakes in this area, but the earthquake that took place happened to take care of all the chains and the things that were holding them down. And not only did it take care of their chains, but the entire prison was set free. Every shackle came down. Every door was opened. And what were they doing before that happened? They were worshiping. How many of us would be in their shoes complaining, crying, just wishing for it to be over? Yeah, I would probably be that in that spot too. If I was just beat, I'd be discouraged. All I got was, don't go to that place, go here instead, and now where am I? I would be wondering, God, what are you doing right now? Where are you exactly? Did you lead me here just to leave me to die? But they worshiped instead. It says in Acts 16:27, when the jailer woke and saw that the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." And the jailer called for lights and rushed in. Trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas, and then he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Worship team, you can come on up. There was a custom of that time if you were a jailer. If you were a jailer and you allowed a single prisoner to escape, death was your only option. It was a great shame if you allowed a prisoner to escape. So what happened? This jailer thought that I just allowed everybody to escape, I have to kill myself. No, suicide does not mean you go straight to hell. Listen. Paul was, this jailer was actually probably one of the people that beat Paul and Silas. He probably joined in and beat them with rods. He probably joined in and mocked them. He was the one that brought them to the inner cell. He was the one that chained them up, put their feet in stocks. But Paul, knowing that this jailer would kill himself if he escaped, we don't see a single prisoner try to leave. But instantly after he was freed, he immediately was concerned for his enemy. You see, the truth is, students, bad things happen to good people. Bad things happen to Christians. And Jesus didn't promise otherwise. In fact, Jesus promised the opposite. Jesus said, "If the world first hated me, they will hate you also." Some of you are still in here and you are still trying to find a place in life where the whole world approves of you. You want to please people so much that when you find out someone doesn't like you, it rules your mind. Some of you have been trying and trying to do the right thing, trying to live right, and yet the world continues to beat you down. And all the enemy wants is to keep you on the ground discouraged, is to keep you in the chains that he put you in. Chains of addiction, chains of suicidal thoughts, chains of doubt. Boys in the front. I don't care. Listen. No matter what it is that's chaining you right now, if you go to God and worship, those chains will fall every single time. Every single time. There is not one addiction that can stand up to the name of Jesus. There is not one suffering that stands up to the love of God. God did not bring you here just to leave you and abandon you. How many times will you need to hear a message on a Wednesday? How many times will you need to hear about the love of God before you realize it is for you? That the message isn't just for the person next to you, it's for you. No words that will ever come out of my mouth, Pastor Payton's mouth, anyone's mouth, will ever be good enough. You have to take the word of God and accept it for you. Believe me, if I could just download to you belief, I would. but only God can do that. If I could just download to you and just make you accept and know that God is real and that God loves you, I would. But not even God did that. God's been waiting here with open arms for you to come to him. Some of you walked in tonight and you're in the inner cell. You're in a dark place. You're alone. You're chained down. You're losing the spiritual war for your soul. But we see a great example in Paul and Silas that despite being at what would be rock bottom for us all, they chose to worship. And maybe you're not in a bad place, but the people around you are in a bad place. We don't see God say that they just set Paul and Silas free. Every single jail cell was opened. Every single bondage was dropped. When you worship God, realize that the impact that you have and the faith that you put forth doesn't just impact you, it impacts those around you. How many messages, I have to ask you again, how many messages will we have to say up on this stage before you decide that your faith is not just for you? That your worship can change someone else's life? You want to see God change your schools? Then when something bad happens in your life, why are you groveling? Stand up and worship. Stop giving in to the discouragement and doing exactly what the enemy wants you to do. He's read you like a book. Enough is enough. Would you agree, students? It's about time we stood up for our faith. No more chains. Maybe God has set you free before, but you chose to pick up those chains and put them back on. God came into your life and shook the foundations of the enemy's stronghold with the love that he brings. He opened the door to your jail cell and you chose to stay there. Why would you stay there? If you're depressed, you do not have to stay there. If you're anxious, you do not have to stay there. If you are lonely, you do not have to stay there. If you're in here, I feel impressed to say this. If you're in here and you're struggling with singleness, it's not even the love month of February, but you're struggling with singleness. Can I tell you something that I learned real quick? I struggled with loneliness my entire life. I grew up in a broken home. I struggled with finding acceptance. I struggled to make friends. No one ever taught me how to be social. And I always thought, someday I'll get to have a normal family. Someday I'll get to get married and I'll be happy then. But then I got married. And I realized that my wife can't cure my loneliness. Do you realize that your loneliness can only be solved by God? And if you sit in a jail cell by yourself, you will never get away from that loneliness. You have to choose to go after God. But when you go after God, realize that when you take one step, he runs after you. You just have to worship. You just have to speak it out in faith. God, I'm at rock bottom, but you are still good. God, you did not lead me here just to abandon me. God, I know you love me. I know you have a plan for me. I know you created me. I know the enemy has no power over me because you died on the cross and rose again 3 days later. You conquered the world, and for that, I am more than a conqueror. I have a righteous anger in my heart for all of you because I am tired of watching youth student after youth student hear the truth of God and forget it the same night and go back to the same losses the very next day. Enough. Are we ready to say enough? Are we ready to say enough? Yeah. Yes.